we are very much in a perfect storm right now.
We are vulnerable to external shocks and supply disruptions.
The attitude towards food and food security here has changed dramatically.
It's one of the smallest, most densely populated countries in the world. With less than 1% of its surface dedicated to growing food, the high-rise urban island state of Singapore seems an unlikely agricultural hub. But that's what a new wave of indoor farms aims to create in congested suburbs. From a modest 162 square meters, Verti Veggies says it can produce more than 10 tons of vegetables a year.
Innovation, technology, this key, because it's not just so much about growing, right? You know, it's really about growing efficiently.
Using specific wavelengths of growth boosting artificial light, it's one of around 260 producers helping a government campaign to boost food security and agricultural technology.
For vertical indoor control environment, indoor farming, you know, one of the things that we do is we look for unutilized spaces or dead spaces.
Outdoor spaces are also being repurposed. Redundant properties like this former secondary school have been cleared to produce and promote homegrown food. City Sprouts covers around 9,000 square meters and aims to get city dwellers interested and involved in sustainable food and agriculture. Hobby farmers share allotments with would-be professional growers.
Before you have a farm, you actually need almost like a farm space to show a proof of concept before you actually can be a licensed farmer. So we kind of come in terms of offering space.
Launched in 2019, the Singaporean government's 30 by 30 policy target is to have 30% of the nation's nutritional needs produced locally by 2030.
Singapore moved away from an agricultural society back in the 60s or 70s and have relied on our neighbours from Malaysia, Indonesia, Thailand, China for imports.
Food security is actually an existential issue for us. Currently, our local food production accounts for less than 10% of our nutritional needs.
As long as supply chains are working, Singapore can afford to buy in food. But panic buying and lockdown shortages in relatively affluent nations over the COVID pandemic proved that supermarket shelves can empty quickly.
We are vulnerable to external shocks and supply disruptions. For example, climate change, disease outbreaks, geopolitical uncertainties.
War in Ukraine, one of the world's major sources of wheat and cooking oil, has piled yet more pressure on supply chains and global food prices, which surged to record highs in 2022.
It's a terrible time to have to rely on food imports. We've had a wave of protectionist measures over recent years. Those measures began with the COVID-19 pandemic. Now everything has gotten a hell of a lot worse due to the conflict in Ukraine.
Singapore has guaranteed trade agreements and a range of options for sourced food from more than 170 countries. But around $105 million has been set aside to help expand business opportunities, including urban farming, alternative proteins, and food safety.
I think the realization is that, you know, even though we can afford to buy food, afford to import either 90% or 70% of food, we need to have some level of self-production here to help us to buffer that period when the disruptions occur. The government policy is not 30% of production, but 30% of our nutrition needs. And this explains why one of the focus areas is alternative proteins. Because proteins are very nutritious, contribute more than their weight in nutrition value.
Singapore signaled its support for alternative proteins when it became the first country to approve a lab-grown meat product for sale in 2020. And in March, US alternative protein company, Eat Just, broke ground on a 2.7 hectare, $120 million production facility there. But whatever the food, producing it locally can be expensive.
We would typically be charging a premium over imported crops, just for the fact that the different cost factors are a lot higher in that sense. We are very much in a perfect storm right now. High costs of energy, high material costs, high manpower, labour costs.
Such costs make local indoor produce up to four times more expensive than conventionally grown imports. But that could change, eventually.
With more innovation, more technology adoption, farms getting more efficient, there's going to be that consolidation of farms across Singapore, and prices will start to balance out as well.
Singapore's plans are ambitious, and there is no guarantee of success.
Singapore's efforts, to my mind at least, they sound very innovative, and with innovation you always have a risk that some things pay off but others don't. And with Singapore being a rich country, I think, you know, there will be a desire, if things don't work, to just rely on food imports instead to plug the gap.
But then again, Singapore is no stranger to reinvention. From the 1960s, driven by the power afforded to its quasi-authoritarian government, it transformed from an island colony with virtually no natural resources to a prosperous city-state dubbed the Monaco of the East. If successful, its plan to transform from import-reliant consumer to leader in urban and high-tech food production could qualify as another economic miracle.